Now that we talk about the general theory behind stream ciphers, now we can talk about individual algorithms. So stream ciphers were generally faster than block ciphers until the lightweight designs came off. So initial designs were a lot faster than block ciphers. Just think about A51 algorithm I just showed you, and think about this block cipher. This is a lot more complicated compared to A51. So for this reason, stream ciphers were generally chosen for situations where communication was not pre-recorded, for instance, in GSM communication, wireless communication, or Bluetooth communication, where you don't have the plain text ready, because in a GSM communication, the plain text is your voice. So before you start talking, you don't have the plain text. And once you start talking, since these algorithms were really old, the technology was not that good in 1990s. So the devices should be able to perform the encryption operation without much losing time, actually. So it should be almost instant. This is why A51 was such a simple design, and it was used in GSM communication. And in web, we use RC4. I mean, for Bluetooth, we have E0. A51 and RC4 are broken, so they should no longer be used. As far as I know, the best attacks on E0 does not cause any real problem. So this is actually the only thing we use here. So we are replacing these algorithms with block ciphers today. For instance, in GSM, we are using Kasumi, which is a block cipher, a variant of MISTI algorithm. And for VPA and VPA2, we have AES. But currently, SALSA is added to TLS communication. So actually, block ciphers were winning, but then stream ciphers came back to the game. So this was mainly because of lightweight designs. We have a lot of very good lightweight block cipher designs that are really fast compared to stream ciphers. This is why there was a paradigm shift, and stream ciphers were kind of forgotten. But these days we are restart talking about them because of the SALSA becoming included in the TLS 1.3 and so on. So in all of these topics, when I talk about competition. So for block ciphers, we had the AES competition. For hash functions, we had SHA-3 competition, and currently we have lightweight cryptography standardization competition by NIST. For stream ciphers, we also had a competition, but this time it wasn't done by NIST, but it was performed by academicians. The eStream competition started in 2004. And it had 34 candidate algorithms, and 7 of them are included in the final portfolio in 2008. So this competition was run for 4 years. There were no Turkish candidates. And the winners are categorized in 2 groups. I said winners, but actually the 7 algorithms that are included in the final portfolio. For hardware, there were 3 algorithms in the final portfolio. Grain version 1, Mickey 2.0, and Trivium. And for software, we had HC128, Rabbit, SALSA, and SOSEMANUG. Trivium became ISO standard for lightweight stream ciphers, and SALSA is now included in TLS 1.3. So when the final portfolio was announced, eStream documentation also said that, final report said that these algorithms should be analyzed more and then should be standardized. And actually, 4 years later, Trivium became a standard, and years later, SALSA became a standard, which we will be talking about at the end of these slides. So let's look at the ISOS standards. NIST doesn't have any lightweight standards, but there's a current competition, but it will be about not directly for stream ciphers, but it will be about authenticated encryption. The winner can be a block cipher, a stream cipher, or a sponge construction, but at the end they will also have the property of authentication. But ISO has lightweight stream cipher standards. They were announced in 2012 and hasn't changed since. There are two algorithms, dedicated key stream generators in the standardization. One of them is Enokoro. It supports two different key sizes, 80-bit and 128-bit. And the second one, which I already mentioned, Trivium, only supports the key of 80 bits, but for current technology, 80-bit wouldn't provide you a very long time security. It can be broken depending on the technology and the devices you have. But if you build dedicated devices for breaking of Trivium, then it can be done in a very short time. So let's start with RC4, which is actually broken and shouldn't be used. Let's talk about why. It was designed by Ron Rivest in 1987 for RSA security. It was kept as a trade secret until it was reverse engineered in 1994. It supports a variable key size. It could be as short as 40 bits and it can be as long as 2048 bits. It is simple, fast, and have large period. We know that its period is larger than this when the key length is 128 bits. It processes the plaintext byte by byte, so it is good for software implementation. It was used, probably still used in many applications like SSL TLS in version 1.0, but it is no longer supported. It was an IEEE standard for wireless communication, which was WEP, I think wide equivalent privacy, which actually didn't provide the same privacy as a wired communication, but anyway. So it starts with a key setup. It is something simple, you know, you just has an actual register like this. These boxes are bytes and you are performing a swap operation and the pseudocode is actually given here. So the algorithm is very simple. The key step part is here and the key stream generation is done like this. It's again kind of a choose of I and J and then, you know, performing some swap operations in them. So you're kind of modifying the internal state like this. The only operations are additions modulo 256. So web uses RC4 to encrypt packets for transmission over wireless communication. To avoid producing the same key stream, web requires each packet to be encrypted with a different RC4 key. RC4 key used for web is concatenation of a 24-bit IV, it should be random, and a 40-bit or 104-bit long-term key. So the IV is really short, 24-bit is not that long, even if it is random. It is open to brute force attacks. So one of the important attacks was due to Fleurer, Mantin, and Shamir in 2001. They observed that the first bytes of the key stream are not random. With certain IVs, an attacker knowing the first byte of the key stream and the first n bytes of the key can derive the n plus first byte of the key. So byte by byte, this attack works and you capture the whole key, but it works with some certain IVs, so we call them weak IVs. So in order for this attack to work, the IV should be weak, but you know, since it is random, there's a high probability at some point you will use a weak IV. First byte of the plaintext in web comes from snap header, which is almost always AA in hexadecimal notation, so this attack is not that hard to perform. But then a better attack was announced. It is you can find it from this paper. It is due to Tevz, Weinman, and Pishkin, breaking 104-bit web in less than 60 seconds. And this attack does not require weak IV, so this is why we call web is broken. So if you have an application which allows you to capture web passwords are actually coming from this paper. So they're actually implementing the attack that is described in this paper. So it should be never used. This attack is, as you can see from the title, is really fast, and you can capture any password of a web in a few seconds. So people should avoid using web actually. They should move on to WPA. So let's move on to another algorithm, which we briefly mentioned before. Now we can see it in a little bit detail. A51 was developed in 1987 and became a GSM standard in Europe and USA. A deliberately weakened version, A52, was developed in 1987 and for certain export regions. It was initially kept secret, but it was reverse engineered in 1999. A GSM transmission is organized as a sequence of bursts in a typical channel and in one direction. One burst is sent every 4.615 milliseconds and contains 114 bits available for information. So you transmit this much bits in this many milliseconds. So A51 is used to produce for each burst a 114-bit sequence of key stream, which is XORed with the same amount of plaintext data prior to modulation. So A51 is initialized by your secret key, which is 64 bits, and a publicly known 22-bit frame, which is actually kind of a random value that depends on the communication. When you call somebody, this 22-bit frame number is determined. And A51 is replaced with A53, which is actually the customer block cipher. And since 3G, we are using it, but we are still seeing examples where we are forced to use A51. A53 supports 384-bit frames when operating in GPRS or in edge mode. So we already seen the picture, but let's see now how it works. So initially you have to, these registers are empty. And to this LFSRs, we start feeding key and the frame as follows. All three registers are set to zero. For 64 cycles, key bits are fed to LFSRs without majority function, which we still hasn't mentioned. So just this topic, and I will tell you what is a majority function later. And after the 64 cycles, for 22 additional cycles, a 22-bit frame number is fed to the LFSRs. Then for 100 additional clocks, with majority function this time, is performed to obtain the initial state. So for 64 cycles, we fed the LFSR. So we run the LFSR 64 cycles, but didn't produce anything. Then we also run it 22 times, so we kept putting values inside the states and start running it, but didn't produce any output. So for 64 and 22 cycles. Now we do it again for 100 additional clocks, but this time we use majority function. And majority function works like this. So assume that we run it for 64 cycles and we fed the key bits one by one from here. Then we did it for the in the same way for the frame number. Now we have some kind of a state here. We start running it 100 times without feeding any more data, but it works like this. So for this 100 cycle, we look at the values here that are shown with a red arrow. So assume that all of them are zero. And this means that majority is zero. So all of these LFSRs are perform one cycle of operation. So they run for one cycle. But assume that not all of them are the same. For instance, it in one state, let's say that this is zero, but these two are one and one. So majority is one. So these two LFSRs are run, but this is not. So majority function actually introduce some kind of a randomness in the system, because depending on the values of these three bits, which LFSRs are going to be run is determined. So this is how the majority function works here. Okay, so if all of them are the same, then all three LFSRs are run, but in most of the cases, two of them will be the same and the third one will be different. For instance, let's say 010. Since the majority is zero, then this LFSR and this LFSR will be run for that cycle. So for 100 additional clocks, we do it, and now we obtain the initial state. So after this 64, 22, and 100 cycles, we will have values here, zeros and ones. So that is your initial state. And after that point on, when you run it again, we will use the majority function, but from when we run it, now we will produce output bits, which will be actually the key stream and will be XORed with your plaintext. And you run it actually 228 clocks to produce this many key bits, and you XOR it with your plaintext. As you can remember, a burst allows you to transmit 114 bits of data. So this is done for actually two bursts, which will be like 8 milliseconds in real life. So how we can break the system? The best attack is, in this case, the exhaustive search attack. Since the key is really short, 64 bits, we can perform the exhaustive search attack. It is easy to guess a part of the GSM communication. In other words, we can guess some blocks of the plaintext. Since we get the ciphertext, you XOR it with your plaintext and you capture the key stream. So if you know the key stream, then you can try every possible key to obtain that key stream. It is easy to capture the ciphertext. Since the communication is wireless, one can stay close to the target or to the base GSM station. So we can always capture some part of the key stream and perform exhaustive search on the key to check if it produces the same key stream. And we perform some operations with our recent GPUs. We can perform 2 to the 34 encryptions using a single GPU. So if you have like 32 GPUs, exhaustive search on the whole key, which is 2 to the 64, would require 2 to the 64 encryptions, would take a year. So if you have a lot more GPUs, you can do it in a few seconds, okay? So you can break it easily. But the thing is that in order to listen to a GSM communication, you cannot wait days and perform that many operations. So can we do it faster? Idea is yes. This can be done by time memory trade-off attacks. So idea is as follows. We cannot spend a year for every exhaustive search. We can do the search once and store the results in a clever way. Such a short search would require 2 to the 64 plus 22, because we don't know which frame will be used in a communication. So we have to perform the, if we do it, this exhaustive search beforehand, we have to do it for all of the frames. So this would require 2 to the 86 encryptions, because we cannot know the frame number at the beginning, but you cannot store that many key streams. So instead of performing exhaustive search on the key and the frame, we can do it on the initial state, which can take at most 2 to the 64 different values. So assume that we have a way to go back from initial state to the key and the frame, but actually it is not necessary. So idea is as follows. Let's go back to the beginning. We set all the registers to zero. For 64 cycles, we fed the key. Then for 22 cycles, we fed the frame number. Then we run it 100 times. Then the initial state is determined. So the initial state at that time are just 64 bits that are here. So let's forget everything that are done until here. And as an attacker, start at this point and try to guess what that initial state is. Since the key stream is produced after this point, just perform the attack to this 64 bits. And if you find the key stream, actually you don't need the key anymore. You can just use that key stream to obtain the plaintext. So attack is really simple. And actually further analysis showed that not every 64-bit key stream can be an internal state. Actually, there's a type error, can be achieved when every key and the frame combination is tried. There are actually at most 2 to the 61.16 initial states. This is a typo, not a key stream. So question is, can we perform a time memory trade-off attack and break the system in real time? And the answer is yes. Because if you perform this exhaustive search once for the initial states, we can perform this many operations. It is easy, but we don't have that much storage. That is the problem, because this would be maybe thousands of petabytes. So question is, the solution is using time memory trade-off attack. So we can reduce the memory cost by using rainbow tables. In 2010, even in a master's thesis in Norway, they generated around 2 terabytes of rainbow tables. And when 114-bit known plain text were given, and from the ciphertext for this key stream, these tables actually can decrypt the GSM communication with probability higher than 19%. But of course, these tables can be generated in a better way. And with today's GPUs, we can generate the same tables. But this time, again, with this gigabyte, it doesn't matter the size, but it matters how many operations you do in before the attack. And if you perform more operations, your probability increases, and you can generate rainbow tables, which would allow you to decrypt any GSM communication that is encrypted with A51, of course, with probability more than 99%. So this is why GSM operators should stop using A51, and most of them are actually no longer using them. But again, it is not sometimes possible, because if somebody wants to use a very old mobile phone, and if it doesn't support A53, then your communication is encrypted with A51. And in some cases, if the base station is really old, then your communication is done by, again, A51. But as you can see, these stream ciphers were early lightweight designs, and they are broken. RC4 and A51 are badly broken. But now we will also give another example, Crypto1, which is badly broken. Then we will move on to current standards, which are not broken yet.